Come on, let's worship the Lord this morning. We're going to give God our best praise, and we're going to give God our best worship. How many chasing the Lord this morning? How many chasing after that blessing? How many chasing after the favor of God that he has upon your life? Come on and worship the Lord with us this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I'm chasing after you, no matter what I have to do, 'cause I need you more and more. Yeah. I'm chasing after you, no matter what I have to do, 'cause I need you more and more. Help me sing, help me say.
I'm chasing after you,
no matter what,
no matter what I have to do,
'cause I need you. Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We give you praise. We're chasing the Lord this morning. And while we're chasing the Lord, we're just giving him this solemn prayer. We thank you, Lord. Through what I have gone through, yeah. Lord, it was you. It was you. Lord, it was you, yeah. Pulling me through. If you know that song, help us sing. Through all, I have gone through. Lord, it was
you.
Yes, it was. Lord, it was
Lord,
you.
It
yes.
Was you.
Yes, it was, Lord. It was you.
It was you.
It was you.
It was you.
Pulling me through.
Pulling me through.
Yes, Lord. It was you, Jesus. It was,
it was you.
Lord,
it was you.
Pulling me through.
Pulling me.
When I stumble,
when I stumble,
when I cry,
when I cry,
when it felt
like
I wanted to
I
die,
wanted to die.
When my friends turned,
when my friends turned,
they left me hanging,
and they walked away.
You were right there,
you were right here.
Yes, you were
right here to stay.
It was you. Jesus said it was you.
It was you.
Lord, it
Lord,
was
it
you.
Was you.
Pulling me through. If you believe it this morning, help us say yes when I stumble.
Oh, yes, when I stumble.
When I cry.
When I cry.
When it felt like,
when it felt like
I wanted to,
I wanted
die.
To die.
When my friends turned.
Stay.
It was you.
It was you.
Oh,
Lord, it was you.
He'll never walk out on you. No, never. No, never. He won't answer. He'll never walk out on you. No, never. No, never. Help me sing to the people.
He'll never walk out on you.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
No, never.
Oh, he'll never.
He'll never walk out on you.
You don't have to worry.
No, never.
He's gonna stay right by
no,
your
never.
Side. He'll never walk out on you.
He'll never.
I'm a witness.
I'm a witness.
That Yes, it was you.
It was you.
It was nobody but you. You pulled me out of the muck and miry clay. It was you.
Good morning, Belonging Fellowship. I'm glad that you have chosen to worship with us on today. I'm thankful that God has kept us even in the midst of these winter advisory reports that have been coming from the news, that we were able to maintain our safety and that we were able to maintain the heat and warmth of our homes. And so I'm just so glad that today we get to warm up with God's Spirit leading us in worship and for us to be together once again to lift up God's name and praise, to lift up our burdens before the Lord, and to worship and exalt Jesus Christ, who is our King. So let us pray and let us continue with worship. Let us pray. God, we thank you this morning for allowing us to have the opportunity to come once again to worship your holy name. God, we thank you for keeping us safe this week. God, we thank you for allowing us to have warmth in our homes, warmth in our bodies, and the blood running warm through our veins. God, we just simply thank you for the opportunity of having this thing called life, that we might live it and live it more abundantly. So God, we thank you for all that you will do, all the things that you have done, and all the things that you are doing right now as we can prepare to worship. So God, we thank you. We ask that you would bless the preacher, bless the musicians, bless those who are worshiping, that we might all come to know you more closely and more dearly as we worship and lift up your name. It's in Jesus' name we say and pray. Amen. All right, Belonging, it is now time for that portion of service where we get to bring our tithes and offerings and to present them to God. And so we are thankful for all the tithes and offerings that you have given us previously. And we thank you right now for what you're about to bless us with. But now we're also thankful, and then we'll be ever so grateful for in the future whenever you give, and as you give to how you see fit to give to Belonging Fellowship. We've been able to do a lot of things together in order to help and do ministry service projects throughout all the communities that we've been able to impact. We've been able to impact families. We've been able to impact communities. We've been able to impact everyone. So as we get ready for offering, there are multiple ways to give. We're still using Cash App, but soon we'll be going away from that. We're able to give through Venmo, and we're able to give through Givelify. And there's some good news. We're excited to let you know that there is this program called Tithely. And Tithely is a way to give money, but then also comes a church app with it. So here shortly, as we get ready to prepare and we get more antiquated with the new app and the new program and software, we'll be able to start rolling them out and how to use videos so that you too can get acclimated to something new, and you can start to dissolve giving through Cash App and through Venmo and Givelify. Now you can still use Givelify, but mostly going away from the Cash App and Venmo. As you've seen, there is some legislation that's being passed where after you give about $600 to those on Cash App and Venmo, then it's starting to get taxed. And so we want to try to get away from that. Not that we're trying to be shady or all that stuff, but this isn't something like you're giving money for a business or anything. This is doing ministry's work. So we have Cash App, Venmo, and Givelify right now, but be excited and praise God for what he's doing through the Tithely app that will roll out to you shortly after we get more comfortable with it to be able to teach you. So let us pray, and then let's give our offerings. God, we thank you for these offerings. God, we thank you for the people who are giving. And God, we thank you for those who will give. And God, we thank you for those who want to give, but for whatever reason, they can't. But God, we just thank you that they give us their attention so that we might be able to tell them about the goodness of God. So God, we love you, and we thank you for blessing us with all these resources so that we might be a blessing to someone else. So God, bless the giver. Make them get, or help them to give, and give cheerfully. Help them to give not grudgingly or of necessity, but because you know, or they know, that you love and you glorify those who give cheerfully. So God, we thank you and we love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Welcome back, Belonging. We thank you for your tithes and your offerings, and we even thank you for the prayers that you are too praying as we carry out this worship service. It is now time to hear God's word read together so that we might prepare to hear a word from heaven from God. I'm going to be delivering today's sermon. I am giving Pastor Tanya a day off so that she can prepare for other church services that she will have to preach on today. So, if you would join me in the book of Jeremiah, the 18th chapter, beginning at verse 1, we'll go through verse 6, and I'll be reading the New Revised Standard Version. So, Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1 through 6. And there you find these words. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and where I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel, as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, "Can I do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, says the Lord." Can I read one more or two verses to you? One translation would read in verse 4, "The vessel he was making of clay was marred in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel and seemed good to him." Verse 6, "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand." Let us pray. God, we come now asking you to send us a word. God, we ask that you would send us a good word, and not just a good word, but a word that'll do us all some good. God, we thank you for last week's sermon and the sermon before the week. And we just thank you for the Bible studies that you have blessed us with so that we might grow closer. So God, we are asking that same thing right now, that you would give us a word that'll help us grow, that'll help us be able to live our life to the potential that you have blessed each and every one of us. Or as you would say in scripture, that you knew before we were even in our mother's wombs. So God, we thank you. And God, we ask that you would decrease chaos, that you might increase that of your Holy Spirit. Speak now, Holy Spirit, speak like you've never spoken before. And when it's all said and done, God, we'll be ever so careful to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Now, Lord, would you bless this food that we're about to receive for the nourishments of our bodies? It is in the matchless and marvelous name of Jesus the Christ we all say and pray. Amen. Amen. So for these next few moments, I'd like, based off the verses that we heard and read from chapter 18 of Jeremiah, I'd like to preach the sermon topic in our series, "I Am Enough, Marred, But I'm in His Hands." Marred, but I'm in His hands. Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, by way of Anathoth, is well into his ministry by now, as we see in the text. Jeremiah was called and sent by God at a young age to tell of the coming destruction towards the people of God, or Israel, if the people of God didn't turn from wicked, evil, paganistic, Baal-worshipping ways. Jeremiah is in a place where it is hard to function, knowing that everything you have said, are saying, can say, and will be said, can put him into stocks, to be mocked, or even into prison by the evil kings who were leading the people of God. But in this particular passage of Jeremiah, God no longer begins with destruction that will come, but God now turns the message, or parable, if you will, to give Jeremiah a message of possibility, opportunity, and of hope. Can I say that one more time? In this particular passage of Jeremiah, God no longer begins with what destruction will come, but God now turns the message, or parable, if you will, to give Jeremiah a message of possibility, opportunity, and of hope. Look what it says in verse 1. "This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you a message." Can we park the car for the first time on this morning? I'm not about to say anything deep or something that calls for deep thought or study. But God calls out to Jeremiah and says, go down. Might I suggest this morning that even in this simple of verses, we can see, we can learn something from Brother Jeremiah. Jeremiah in his business, Jeremiah in his depressive state, Jeremiah in his anxious state, Jeremiah in his paranoia state, Jeremiah in his inability to be aware of self and be assured of self in that state. Here's God called out to him, and Jeremiah stops everything he's doing to hear what God has to say to him. Maybe one of our problems we face as individuals is God calls us in the midst of our issues. God calls us in the midst of our depression. God calls us in the midst of our anxiety. God calls us in the midst of our imperfections, but we don't take the time in our business and all the things, the afflictions and the things that we deal with. We don't take the time to stop as Brother Jeremiah does. And as a result, we miss hearing God speak, which leads us to not going where we should or being able to better handle the situations that we are in as we should, or as in trouble, trials and tribulations arise in our lives. But Jeremiah continues to be obedient and stops to listen and to hear what God has to say. Look what he writes, verse 3. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. Jeremiah sees the potter sitting at the wheel working on his craft. A potter's wheel turns slowly or faster depending on the craft the potter is making. The wheel is also beneficial to the potter simply because as the wheel turns, the potter is able to see the whole masterpiece he is working on. Can I say that one more time? The wheel is also beneficial to the potter simply because as the wheel turns, the potter is able to see the whole masterpiece he is working on. We should rejoice right now. We should stop right there and rejoice this morning, knowing that if God is the potter and we are on the potter's wheel, God sees our wrongs. He sees the anxiety we are dealing with. God sees the depression. God sees our inadequacy. God sees our incompetence. God sees our unawareness or our inability to see the goodness and the value in our lives and that we need. And God can see the places that need improvement. He knows the additions that we need to be made. Because as the potter, we are on that wheel and God is slowly turning the wheel to make sure he sees all the picture that we're dealing with. But verse 4, but the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as it seemed best to him. Belonging, we've been journeying through these last few weeks about I am enough and dealing with loving self and dealing with being able to handle the situations that when they arise in our life, that we have a better response to when we feel less than, when we feel like we are marred or afflicted, when we don't think so much of ourselves, when we think that we are not valuable. We have been going through that for the last few weeks. But I want to say we can celebrate and that we can rejoice based off what we're seeing right now, because we know all ultimately, we almost know where this is headed. Verse 4, it says, but the pot, or if we wanted to make it more personable, but the individual he was shaping from that clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as it seemed best to him. Other translations, the potter crushed the jar because it did not turn out as he wished and started over. Belonging, let me put this disclaimer out there right now. I'm not suggesting that the things that you encounter in your life is God breaking you or God breaking you and making you into something other and starting over. I want to suggest, based off what we hear, is that the potter is aware of all the marredness in that particular artifact, or in this case, the vessel that he's working with. And because the potter sees that you're marred, the potter is able to use their hands. The potter is able to use words. God is able to use the different tools that God needs to in order not to necessarily break you down, but to shape it so it may seem better or seem best to him. some of the issues that we face is we try to go to each and everything that is not God and thinking that it might shape us to be better. It may shape us to be more value. It may shape us to lose or to lessen the depression. It may shape us to help us lessen the anxiety, when ultimately, whenever we look to those things that are not the potter, that are not God, it leads us into a more depressive, more anxious, more paranoia, and more less value position. But if we're looking at the words for what they're meaning, it says to be marred means to have blemishes or to be disfigured. I woke up this morning, I'm not disfigured, but I do know that I have some blemishes. I do know that there's some things that I deal with in my personal experiences that I could even deem them as blemishes. I know that I deal with some mental health issues, blemishes. I know I do struggle with some things when it comes to how I'm to respond to the things and the adversity around me. It's blemishes. This suggests not that them are the be, to be marred means to have blemishes. But this does not suggest that God created us with blemishes, but that our lives gain blemishes as we go through this experience. Can I say that again? To be marred does not mean that God created us with blemishes, but as our lives gain blemishes, we have a potter who is able to make us whole again. We're not the only ones that have dealt with blemishes or being marred in our lives. You had David. David definitely had some marred or blemishes in their life. Abraham had some marredness or blemishes in his life. Mary, the mother of Jesus, had marred or blemishes in her life. Deborah had some marred and blemishes in her life. Samson had some marred and blemishes in their life. Paul had some marred or blemishes in our life. But I want to suggest that if God the potter can reshape them, make them whole, even in the midst of their marredness and their blemishes, it simply means God can do it for you and for me. We should celebrate that on this morning. I might be marred. I might have my blemishes, but because I'm in God's hands, because I'm marred, but because I'm in the potter's hands, God can do and work in me something new that I might become better, not as it seems to me, but as it seems in God's eyes. Verse 5, it says, the word of the Lord came to me. He said, can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does? Can I read that one more time to make it personal? He said, can I not do with you, Chaz, as this potter does? Can you just insert your name in verse 6? He said, can I not do with you, Tanya? Can I not do with you, Taylor? Can I not do with you, Hunter, as this potter does, declares the Lord? Like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hands. Belonging, let me read verse 6 again to you. God said, can I not do with you, belonging, as this potter does, declares the Lord? Like the clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, belonging. We should be able to rejoice this morning, knowing that no matter what we are going through in our lives, no matter what inadequacy we may feel, no matter what affliction that we go through, no matter what depression that we may go through, no matter what anxiety that we go through, no matter what instance that we go through in life that shapes us or molds us or even causes us to feel like we are less valuable, that we are not redeemable, that we are not of any good to those surrounding me, we should celebrate and rejoice that no matter what those instances may be, we're still in the potter's hands. No matter what we face, we're in God's hands. When the enemy encamps about us and make us feel like we will lose everything, we're in his hands. When our children don't act right, they don't submit to the instruction that we give to, they are, and in his hands. When the job gets stressful and it makes you feel like you got to throw the towel in, we're in his hands. When I can't get past my pride to help do this self-work that I'm doing, I'm marred, I'm blemished, but I'm in his hands. Is there anybody that can testify and you can rejoice today that you might have your blemishes, but thanks be to God that you're in God's hands? Belonging, I'm done. I believe that one thing that we can acknowledge, even in this self-work that we're doing, that being marred does not necessarily mean that you are less than. If anything, in this walk, this spiritual walk that we're doing, whenever I say I am enough, that suggests that even in my marredness and my blemishes, I'm still enough, because what I go through, God is able to work something new and create in me something new as it seems best to him, not myself. Belonging, I'm done. Maybe you came this morning and you felt marred, you felt blemished, you felt like there was nothing that can help you in this self-work journey that you're in. I want to suggest that the things that you may be feeling in life is nothing but you spinning around on this wheel of this thing called life. But I want to suggest that there is this divine potter who, as he sees you go around one time, oh, they got a blemish. God sees it and works it out for you. As God continues to see, oh, there's another one. He doesn't knock you off the wheel. He just simply says, oh, there's another thing. God touches it with his finger of love and says, anxiety, rest. The wheel keeps spinning, and as you get bumped and bruised in your social areas of life, you develop depression, you develop anxiety, you develop a sense of less value of self. God sees that, and God says, touches it with his fingers and his thumbs of love and says, my child, that does not define you. Maybe that's you this morning. And you've been waiting to hear something that speaks to the positive side of things. You can be marred, but you can still be in God's hand. If that's you this morning, why don't you send us a message in so that we might be able to talk with you, that we may be able to pray with you. Maybe you've heard this and based off knowing that you're marred, and somebody, you felt like being marred caused you that you weren't even acceptable unto God. But today you want to make it right with God. If that's you, why don't you DM us and we'll pray with you. We'll help you to understand what it means to have a relationship with God. Maybe you just simply need prayer. Why don't you DM us and send us what you desire for God to do in your life? What is that marredness? What is that blemish that you were asking and seeking God to help you with while you're on this wheel? God is the potter, and God forms us, God's vessels, as it seems best to him and not us. So let us pray. God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for Brother Jeremiah and the story that you used through his life. God, we thank you for using the parable of being the potter and having a vessel that seemed spoiled, that seemed marred, that seemed to have blemishes. But yet the potter, who is you, touches it not with a finger of just judgment, but a finger of love to help rework that pot. That you work that vessel so that it might be better as it seems to you and nobody else. God, forgive us of the times that we have said of your vessels that you created that it's not enough, that we're not valuable, that we can amount to anything. Forgive us of those moments, God, because we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that we are made in the image and likeness of you. So God, we ask that you would bless those who are searching for a relationship for you. God, we are praying for those who have a relationship with you, but times feel disconnected from you. And God, we are praying for those who right now, their visions of themselves and the lack of self-love seems to disconnect them from you. Help each and every one of us as we deal with our own experiences. Help us to draw near unto you, God. It is in Jesus' name we say and pray. Amen. Belonging. You know what it said, and we said it all along. Have a great week. Know that you'll have some blemishes arise, but ultimately know that you may be marred, you may have blemishes, but you're in God's hands. If nobody's told you today, Belonging, I love you. Pastor Tanya loves you, and so does the Lord. Have a great week. Stay warm, and we'll see you at Bible study.